Hey, vinyl community. Welcome back to Dad's on the Budget Vinyl. My name is Mark. I appreciate you coming by today, hanging out. We found out on Friday the 1st that we had lost another great, Jimmy Buffett. Sad times, right? My wife suggested that I do a Jimmy Buffett showcase. And at first, I kind of shied away from the idea. The reason for that is I don't know if I saw myself as a big enough Buffett fan. And secondly, I didn't want anybody to think that I was trying to capitalize in any way, shape, or form on someone's demise. However, in retrospect, number one, I'm a bigger Buffett fan than I thought I was. And number two, you know, we're going to start losing folks more and more regularly, and it's just the way that it is. Jimmy Buffett was born in 1946, and you know, if you were born, say, between 45 and 50, then by the time the Beatles came to America and played Ed Sullivan, you were, you know, anywhere from 10 to 15 years old. So many people at that time coming out making music, and a lot of those guys now are pretty long in the teeth. You know, fortunately we still have Paul, and we still have Bob, and we still have Eric, and you know, we still have Mick and Keith. I remember seeing the Stones back in 85, and you know, I thought they were ancient then, and now it is almost 40 years later and those cats are still playing. So you know, but that's not always the case, and a lot of our musical heroes and icons are in their 70s and even their 80s now. And it's just a fact of life. Ashes to ashes, dust to dust. We're all gonna, our flesh is gonna come to an end one day. But it doesn't always have to be sad. Sometimes we can celebrate. And in the course of Jimmy Buffett, that's exactly what I'd like to do. James Delaney Buffett III was born on Christmas Day, 1946. Isn't it funny that the day that Jimmy Buffett was born was the day that W.C. Fields, that sarcastic comedian, W.C. Fields, passed away? And isn't it ironic that on the day that W.C. Fields decided to skip out on the big party, Jimmy Buffett was born on a day in which he knew that there was always going to be a party, Christmas Day. Born in Pascagoula, Mississippi, and really, you got me right there. I love the South. Pascagoula, what a great name. Mississippi, what a great name. Jimmy Buffett's granddad was a boat captain out of Newfoundland. His dad was a maritime boat engineer, mechanical engineer, and also a boat enthusiast, a sailing enthusiast in his own right. And so, you know, Jimmy, right off the bat, was immersed in captains and pirates and sea shanties and all of that type of thing. And, you know, being born in Pascagoula, spending some formative time there, moving to Mobile, Alabama, and Fairhope. Later on, New Orleans, Nashville, Florida, Key West. I mean, he lived all over the place, and you know, he picked up what great places to live and grow up and be around if you're gonna write about eccentric characters like boat captains and pirates and, you know, island ladies and palm beaches and sand and margaritas and cheeseburgers and, you know, what a great place to grow up. And he absorbed all that stuff. And he's also a voracious reader, huge fan of Mark Twain and Tennessee Williams and William Faulkner and later on writers like Terry Southern. And, you know, he absorbed all of that stuff into his writing style. You know, Mark Twain was the one that said, write about what you know. And I think Jimmy Buffett has always done that. He writes about what he knows. Jimmy Buffett became hugely successful. He's got 29 studio releases, I believe. 8 of those went gold, 9 of them went platinum. He's got several best-selling books. He was able to parlay his musical career into clothing lines and a couple of restaurant chains and a couple of liquor labels and books and children's books and the whole nine yards. Formed the Coral Reefer Band in 1975, toured with them up until just, I believe, last year, one of the highest grossing acts of all time. Shows were always sold out. But it hadn't always been that way. Jimmy Buffett certainly couldn't really get anything together in Florida, in Mobile, Alabama. And he took off and left there for New Orleans, got a couple of gigs and some strip clubs and, you know, jerking beers and a couple of clubs that would allow him to go on for a 5, 10, 15 minute set, but couldn't really get it together in New Orleans either. Ended up going to Nashville. It was Nashville that fortunately he met up with Jerry Jeff Walker, Jerry Jeff Walker of Mr. Bojangles fame. Jerry Jeff was the one that suggested to Jimmy that he head down to Florida, see what was going on, and he could stay at his place in Coconut Grove. And that's where Jimmy really fell in love with Florida. Jerry Jeff came down to hang out with him, and together the two of them went down into Key West to do some busking. And that's where Jimmy just really fell in love with the tropical paradise that he would write about for the rest of his life. Still kind of floundered around. Jimmy finally got someone to put a record out for him. It didn't do well. I think it sold 324 copies. But then in 1973, Jim Croce passed away in a plane crash, and ABC Dunhill, Croce's label, came seeking out Buffett and immediately started promoting him as the next Jim Croce. His first record, I believe, for ABC Dunhill was White Sport Coat and a Pink Crustacean. I mean, a White Sport Coat and a Pink Crustacean. I mean, just check out that track, that album name. But that's Jimmy Buffett, right? And it did moderately well. It has Why Don't We Get Drunk and a couple other tunes that got some radio play. But it wasn't until this record, Living and Dying in 3/4 Time. I love this record. I love that saying. A good friend of mine, Chris Mills, he'll use that. Hey man, how you doing? Oh, you know how it is. Living and Dying in 3/4 Time. But look at that. Look at that photo. And there you have Jimmy Buffett. I mean, there he is on this half-sunk boat called the Good Luck. Okay? And you can see that not very far away is a shark waiting to snag him. And then I love this from inside. Okay? And this is the album that has the track Come Monday. And Come Monday was a pretty big song for Jimmy. He tells the story of writing the song on the David Letterman show years later. He said that at the time he was stuck in a Holiday Inn, was absolutely, literally, was really, really miserable. But you know, he knew that by Monday, things would be all right. And he sat down and came out with that song. And we all know him and love him for it. A1A. That famous highway in Florida that hooks up from the mainland down into the Keys. Another one of those nautical theme, Florida theme records. And another one of those, I mean, I love Florida Keys. Lots of pictures of Jimmy doing his thing, right? And what a, you know, I say what a great guy. I mean, the reason I say that is because you see interviews with him, you see photos of him, he's always smiling. Maybe a pair of cargo shorts or some blue jean cutoffs, pair of flip-flops and his guitar. Most of the time back in the day, he would be photographed shirtless. And that was Jimmy. That's how Jimmy did his thing. Look at what I picked this up for. Havana Daydreaming 450. This is another corker of a record. And I love the record cover. And again, Jimmy shirtless, and a couple of boat photos. But I love this record cover. And, you know, that's Jimmy. And, you know, they say that the wrinkles are only the lines left over from where the smiles were. And this guy, always smiling, always happy, always ready to start a party and sing some songs and eat a cheeseburger and drink a margarita and have some fun. And I love that. And, you know, in my opinion anyway, you can't fake that. You can't fake that with the pressures of the record industry and trying to have a marriage while being a touring musician and the pressure of coming out with a new record or the pressure of going on tour, all of that kind of stuff. But, you know, if you truly love what you do, and Jimmy would plan his tours around things that he wanted to do, a place that he wanted to go fly fish, or a place that he wanted to go sailing, or a place that he wanted to go parasailing, or whatever. So we always had a little mixture of all of that together, and everywhere he went, he had his little notebook, and every weird, quirky character that he met, he'd just about write a song about. Son of a Sailor, one of my favorite songs, Buffett songs, and the song that was playing when this video started, one of my favorites, and another typical Buffett record. Captain Jimmy, right? Captain Jimmy. How do you not love that guy? Right? This is the record, really, that really put him on the map. This is Changes in Latitudes, Changes in Attitudes. You know that song, and you know Wasted Away in Margaritaville. But, I mean, so many good songs. Still writing about Biloxi, Tampico Trauma, Banana Republics. I mean, you know, the guy just never stopped, and look at that. Look at that back photo. His first record of the 80s. This record, this photo was taken on the beach in January. And I think it's the only time I've ever seen Jimmy Buffett in a sweater. Probably looking about as yuppie as Jimmy Buffett ever looked, okay? But, and I love his version of Stars Fell on Alabama on this. But, you know, what a great tunesmith, what a great songwriter, what a great lyricist. He would take you there, right? Whether he was singing about the salt spray or the seagulls or the rum or the tequila or the salt shaker or the... It just didn't matter. He could take you right there. You know, I have to say that when Jimmy Buffett first really kind of exploded, probably the main reason that I wasn't a huge fan was because I was a young kid. I was into rock and roll, man. I wanted to listen to rock and roll. And, you know, I didn't get the singer-songwriter thing. I mean, back then we had a ton of them. You know, the aforementioned Jim Croce and Jimmy Buffett, Harry Chapin, Jackson Browne, Andrew Gold, James Taylor, Neil Young, all of these guys kind of in the singer-songwriter mode. I didn't really get it. It just didn't rock hard enough for me. But as you get older, you know, as I got older, I moved away from Birmingham, Alabama when I was 18. I thought it was the armpit of the South, literally. Couldn't wait to get to the big city. But, and I moved to Dallas, Texas, pretty big city. But over the years, you know, I would come back home to spend time with my friends and family on holidays, and I fell back in love with the South and all things Southern and Southern writers and Southern music. And, you know, some of those softer songs, acoustic guitar strummed or finger picked with lyrics that you can actually understand, that tell stories, things and lyrics that give you an immediate imagery for what the artist is singing about. That living room music, that sitting at the beach around the campfire music, that back porch music, truly, truly, truly wonderful. As a lyricist, Jimmy was able to segue that into a wonderful writing career. I had no idea, and one time I had a trip planned to the beach, and a friend of mine put this book in my hands and said, take that, you'll enjoy it. And boy, did I. This is Tales from Margaritaville. Margaritaville is to Jimmy Buffett what Lake Wobegon is to Garrison Keillor. Wonderful, wonderful story about weird, quirky Southerners and then Floridians and, you know, from Carl Hyson to Jimmy Buffett. You read a book about Florida, there's some strange goings on down in Florida, right? Not all of it Southern, a lot of Northerners that come down there to retire. So all kinds of quirky personalities, all kinds of people. But this is a wonderful book. If you've read the short story about Tully Mars, the cowboy, and well, then you know what I'm talking about. But there are semi-autobiographical things in here. There's a chapter called Walkabout that really takes his life and kind of compares it to an Aboriginal walkabout, and that's a wonderful, wonderful thing. But the Heatwave Chronicles about Heatwave Florida and the softball team and the hot dog stand and the alligator, just all of that, really, really wonderful. It'll have you laughing out loud. And then Margaritian Madness. And then lastly, Son of a Sailor, with chapters like Hooked in the Heart, Life in the Food Chain, A Gift for the Buccaneer, and Sometimes I Feel Like a Rudderless Child. So this was an absolutely wonderful, wonderful read. That led me, anyway, to Pirate Looks at 50. I liked it enough that I had to go ahead and pick up the hardback as well. But again, look at him there. On the beach with his boat, with his seaplane, okay? And Pirate Looks at 50 is also semi-autobiographical, even though it's about a drug smuggler in the 70s. Jimmy knew plenty of those guys, may have even done a little bit of it himself, but wonderful, wonderful book and a wonderful read. And, you know, it's not just about the drug smuggler and all of that. It's also about turning 50 and the self-reflection that comes with that, and realizing that we're getting older and, you know, that we're not going to live forever and that we're mortals and that one day we're going to pass away. And his take on all of that is just wonderful. So do yourself a favor and check it out. Where is Joe Merchant is one that I also own, and it might even be my favorite. But I can't find it to show it to you, so I'm not. And then last but not least, Salty Piece of Land. And I love that back photo as well. It's another great little read. It didn't do for me what Tales of Margaritaville and A Pirate Looks at 50 and Where's Joe Merchant did. Those books, I thought they were brilliant and hilarious all at the same time. Very honest, very cool. So we started off this video with me doing a little video collage of a collage that I did that was primarily inspired by this book. I picked this book up before I was ever a Jimmy Buffett fan. I was at a Half Price Books one day. I picked it up. I started thumbing through it. I thought it was really, really cool. There are so many great photos in here that I ended up going back and getting a second copy of it so that I would have one that I could cut up and collage and do my thing. And that's what we were looking at when this video started. I had a dog-eared spot in here that, of course, now I can't find. But I just this is the epitome of Jimmy Buffett. I love this photo. And I love greetings from Florida, Key West, Florida, southernmost city in the U.S. That's Jimmy Buffett, man. You know, all of the history that goes with that. And this book is absolutely filled with people that influenced him, people that he's got great stories to tell with. Here's him hanging out at Rancho Deluxe with Jeff Bridges and Sam Waterson. Here's Joe Don Baker playing Buford Pusser. So let's tell that story real quick. Jimmy Buffett, like any Southerner, has got a ton of stories. And like any good Southerner, he also embellishes those. My wife says that I'm the Southern embellisher. I tell the truth. I just generally make it sound a little more interesting than it actually was. But, in 1974, Jimmy Buffett was playing a show, also in town, in close proximity to where he had just played. Buford Pusser was at a sheriff's convention. And Jimmy and his band had just finished up a recording. They loved the way that it sounded. They went out to celebrate. Several of the band members went for champagne. Jimmy went for tequila, and him and two of his buddies got a bottle of Jose Cuervo tequila and three straws, and within about 15 minutes were three sheets to the wind. They got the munchies and went out to the parking lot and tried to find their car, and they couldn't. Jimmy was in a little rented Gremlin, and they couldn't find his vehicle in this sea of vehicles. At the time, he was wearing a pair of golf shoes that he had removed the metal cleats from the bottom of. But they still made quite a racket, and he had climbed up on a car to try to get a better view of the parking lot so that he could locate his. And he heard a voice saying, "Stop right there, don't move, you're under arrest." At which point in time, Jimmy turned around and politely said, "You can kiss my ass." Jumped off the car and ran to his car with this big, huge person on his tail. Turned out that big, huge guy was Buford Pusser. Now, if you didn't grow up in the South in the 70s, you may not know who Buford Pusser was, but, you know, there were three people that we talked about fairly religiously, and that was Bear Bryant, George Wallace, and Buford Pusser. Buford Pusser was the sheriff of McNair County, Tennessee. He was, by God, going to clean that county up of its prostitution and illegal gambling rings. And he did so with a great big old stick, and was made famous in the movie Walking Tall. Joe Don Baker played him. And then later on, I can't remember the name of the movie that Dwayne Johnson was in, Rundown or something like that. What was it, honey? Do you remember?
It was either Walking Tall or Standing Tall. I can't remember.
Standing Tall or Walking Tall. Anyway, you know, those were, you know, that was Buford Pusser, and that was the guy that was running after Jimmy Buffett for standing on his car in metal cleats. And he catches up to him and proceeds to lean over and through the open roll down window, proceeds to pretty much beat the crap out of Jimmy and his buddy. And Jimmy says that Buford grabbed him by his hair. And for about the next 3 months, he had a bald spot on the back of his head. I remember in 1974, about 3 months after that incident, I came home from school one day, and someone had run Buford Pusser off the road, shot his car up, and he was obviously killed. Made the national news, so it was a great big deal. But Jimmy Buffett had tons of stories like that, and that's what we're going to remember him by. His music, his lyrics, his storytelling, his smile. Jimmy Buffett was one of a kind, and we're going to miss him. And it's in that the honor of the light of his music and his contribution and his legacy that we do this video today. Rest in peace, Jimmy Buffett. We'll miss you, buddy. Take care.